All right, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is your midweek Pocket Change Market Report video, this time for August 25th, 2021. It's looking like we're going to have one more Pocket Change report before the end of the month is all said and done as we head into September. Probably a very pivotal month throughout the year where we begin to see a transition between what is normally kind of like the off season of coins as it transitions into the more busier time for numismatics when collectors and investors and dealers come back into the picture. And usually the fall time is always ripe with more activity. But I could honestly say the pocket change sector of numismatics, where just everyday Joes like, you know, myself and a lot of you, you know, we go out and we search out these errors and varieties in pocket change or maybe through coin roll hunting. But at the same time, if you're lucky enough to have a local coin shop or a coin show, people also like to cherry pick some pretty amazing stuff. We're going to highlight everything that people had decided that they didn't need in their collection and make some money in the process. For those of you that are new here, just wanted to reiterate, all the coins are fresh, raw, ungraded, which means they're not sent off to PCGS or NGC. They're not in these slab holders, which normally would give some of these coins a little bit of a premium. But, you know, at the end of the day, there are just certain errors of varieties that are just not worth grading. You know, you could turn around, sell it, make 10, 20 bucks. If you did grade it, they'd still be worth $10, $20. It's one of those lessons that I continually push to a lot of searchers out there, just so it's on the top of your mind. There's a very short list of coins I would say is deserving of a graded slab holder. And that would be a conversation for another time, but in the spirit of pocket change searching, there are certain coins that, you know, just don't need the graded holder. It'll save you money in the long run too. In addition, it's a good way to make a few bucks. You know, here we are coming up onto the holidays. You know, make some extra cash, you know, maybe $100 or $200 a week. Just look out for some of these coins and, you know, you won't be disappointed. And, you know, the fall time brings out more interested buyers for these coins. All right. So we're going to take a look at the last 24 to 48 hours of activity. Usually the weekend pocket change report doesn't capture that. But we have a lot of really awesome coins on the list here that I'm glad I'm able to put and put in place a midweek report for you guys, so you can take a look at some of these other coins that are otherwise left off the list. All right, so let's go ahead and jump right in. These are all seller provided photos. So it is what it is. There's going to be some that are obviously out of focus or too dark. Those are going to be reflected into the images. The first one that we have here is a set of two, actually blank planchets. All right, so this is before the strike, but as you can see, they have what appears to be the upsetting process where the edge has been raised a little bit or cupped. They put these through the upsetting mill, and it converts normal type 1 planchets that don't have that upset rim to it and turn them into type 2. So we have two type 2 planchets, but from what denomination are they? Well, these are from 50 cent planchets. So let's just say Kennedy half dollars. These are clad, as you can see there, they've got the copper nickel sandwich appearance to the edge. Nothing's been struck on them. They have no reading. So that's what we have here. And this is a set of two through 9 bids. This pair sold for $57, which is a strong amount of money. And it's deserved of that kind of money because the larger denomination blanks, whether they're Kennedy halves or whatever, and some of the like other more obscure blanks like Ike Dollar blanks or Susan B. Anthony or whatever, these always command a little bit extra money on the secondary market. You just don't see them that often. The next one that we have here is a coin that I would say a lot of you have probably passed up, and that's okay. This one is rather fair weathered and under the radar. Not many people look for the little tiny cut die breaks on these statehood quarters. There are a few, I guess, key states to look out for. Colorado's one of them. West Virginia. Let's see, Idaho with the bird and the state profile on the reverse. Let's see. There's a few of them. Iowa might be another one as well, but usually they're right on the rim, and right here you could see the rim connected to the mountainous terrain with a broken die piece on there. So this is what it would look like without that piece from the die transposed onto the coin. It would just be a void, and it's raised on there. So that's what they call a cud die break. Cuds generally involve some part of the rim, and it goes into the design. This is rather minor, I'll be honest, but even the minor cuds still do command a few bucks. This one right here, in its current condition state, it looks pretty rough, sold for $4.95. So that's 20 times face value. You know, if you look at it that way, you know, there is a lot more value proposition in selling things like this. Again, it's the total sum of the parts, and it's not just about looking for like the high dollar stuff that you could pitch right away. They all add up. There's a little bit of a close-up of that cud, as you can see, and these do get bigger, so there are progressions of this particular one. Now, this one's pretty cool. Some of you probably say, well, oh, that's pretty neat. It's a detached lamination. However, based on what I'm seeing here, I don't see any rough edge to where I could say it's a detached lamination. Rather, this is a coin that was struck through a detached lamination piece from another coin, and it landed on what I would suspect to be the anvil die. So this little piece or little shred of that previous struck coin ended up onto the die before the next blank planchet was fed into the striking chamber, and then that's what we're seeing here. Just a simple strike through of a detached lamb from another coin. Pretty neat, by the way. This one right here, again, check out condition. This one has circulated quite a bit. Sold for $5.95. So definitely a coin that I would not overlook or toss back. As minor as it may be because of its lower condition, these command a nice dose of premium on the secondary market. Okay, so this one's pretty wild. This is probably the most wildest off-center struck copper-coated zinc planchet era coin that I have seen in quite a while. So this is a post-1982 Lincoln, all right? So we went from a transitional changeover from the outgoing bronze composition into this crappier copper zinc-coated coin. But this is an off-center coin, off-center struck by, I would say, about 65%. We don't have a date on here, so we don't know when this was from. Some people collect these by the date, and that's where a lot of the big premium is associated. But you just see a lot of pull away, a lot of tear in the copper plating on this, and that's why you have a lot of exposed zinc on here. This is actually quite common, but this is kind of more on the more dramatic side, I would say. Just lots of exposed zinc. Again, take care if you own some of these to store them in a moisture-free environment, because any sort of moisture or humidity will do a number on that zinc core. This one right here, ladies and gentlemen, sold for $6.61. Here's another one here. This is probably more along the lines of what I normally find out there, but this is a 1990 Lincoln. This one is off-center by about 20%. It's got a full date. You do have a little bit of pull away of that copper plating. It's most notable on or noticeable on the reverse. Jeez. Most noticeable on the reverse. And again, this is a date-specific off-center coin. If someone needed it for a date set of off-center struck coins, this is a good candidate right here. And this one sold for $15.24. And then from the same seller, he also offered up a 91 as well. This one is not quite as off-center. This one is about like 15%-ish, somewhere around there. It's a decent-looking coin, although it does have a spot of corrosion here in one of the memorial bays. This one right here sold for $15.24 as well, probably to the same buyer. Now here's a quarter that's off-center struck, this one by about 30-35%, give or take. It's a decent example. Believe it or not, it looks like it's circulated a little bit, which, if I came across this as a non-coin collector, I would say that this thing looks weird enough that I would pull it out of change and just hold on to it. But this one looks like it's been around a block, and it's just, I find it hard to believe that this has passed through, a few dozen hands at this point. But it is 1989. You just never know. This one right here through seven bids, so this must be a key date. Sold for $46.45. Now, when I say key date, it's a key date in the sense that you don't see this particular date off-center struck. Like I had alluded before, there are collectors that buy these by date, and then they go and fill out a date set of off-center struck quarters. Now, here's a re relatively recent coin on the list. Now, I've talked about this one before, but hey, we'll go ahead and rehash it because it's important to kind of keep the devil in the details when you're out there searching, especially when you have coins from 2019, 20, and 21, which are just plentiful out there. And for those of you that live on the East Coast, this is a good one to look for. These still carry some value, even circulated, which, this one clearly is. It's a 2020 Philadelphia Salt River Bay ATB quarter. This one right here is the doubled die obverse 001. All right, so this one right here, as you can see, shows significant thickness along with some of that stretching in all of the letters, and even the mint mark is a lot thicker since the mint mark is part of the master die, and these are not punched in independently like the good old days, from like the 80s. You're not going to get repunched mint marks on these. So if there's any doubling, it's also going to affect the mint mark. This particular coin sold for 15 bucks. All right, keep in mind it's a little bit circulated, probably an AU or maybe Mint State 61 type of coin. So there you go. Here's another off-center struck Lincoln. This time we have a considerably tougher date. We have a 1970D, and this one, out of focus as it is, and a lot of that it's attributed to where it's photographed in. This is actually still in a 2x2 cardboard holder. And like I tell a lot of folks, and I'll tell you guys right now, if you're going to sell your coins, keep in mind, keep this in your brain, take your coins out of your holder. These things are a dime a dozen. They're easy to replace. If you have a hard time, getting more of these 2x2 holders, heck, shoot me an email and I'll send you some for free. I have an absolute crap ton of these, and that's why I say if you're going to monetize and sell these online, take them out of the holder. You're going to get better quality photos. You're going to get less glare, kind of like what you see right here. But at the end of the day, it's a great looking coin. It's in really nice shape. 70D, probably a more key date for off-center collectors. The seller had said that this was a saddle strike, which would indicate a double struck coin. I just don't see the second strike anywhere on here. So I would say I would disagree on this being an actual saddle strike, true to a sense. This one through 12 bids sold for $51. So that's a really strong amount of money for this coin. Our first multi-coin lot is going to be these two quarters. So we have a 1966 Washington that has a easy to spot curve clip here right above LIB and Liberty. And then you also have this 1984 P Washington quarter, where this one right here is a partial tilted collar. So you can see it just kind of like that railroad rim area. The obverse of the coin will appear to be more off-center, while the reverse of the coin looks pretty decent, although you can see just the slight shift right here. And then there's your 66 with a curved clip. This one also exhibits a little Blakeslee effect on the opposite side there. So this two coin lot sold for $16. And I'll bring it up really brief, but when I see multi-coin lots, I always pay attention to these. Because if there's a way for you to make money, I would certainly consider multi-coin lots that have some pretty decent material in them, especially if they go for cheap. Because you could always part them out and sell them individually. Maybe there's a coin or two that you need for your collection. That's also another great thing about these multi-coin lots. But through it all, there is always a way to make a few extra bucks by simply buying up these lots and selling them, and hopefully doubling your money. You know, that's where you want to be. You want to double your money on these coin lots. So 16 bucks is what we're looking at here on these two quarters. All right. Wow. So our highlight coin of the week is going to be this 1959 Lincoln Memorial cent. Check out the reverse. Now, isn't that like the biggest retained lamination piece they've ever seen on an older coin like this? I'm surprised this thing hadn't fallen off a long time ago. So yeah, that's what exactly what we have here. We just have a plain Jane large lamination peel on the reverse that's still stuck to the coin. This is its hinge area right here. So again, I'll tell everybody this: do not take that lamination piece off. Keep it on the coin. Some people find it necessary to have to, you know, detach this thing and then resell it as a two-piece lot. Yeah, you might be able to get a few bucks more in the process, but boy, are you going to be on the receiving end of a lot of third-degree stuff, man. Those comments are going to come rolling in if you did that. But this one right here, there is also another kind of like three-quarter view turn on that lamination. I mean, you got, man, that thing's all wicked crazy. And the fact that all of the design devices on the actual piece right here is so strong, man. This thing is attractive. This one right here, 45 bids combined. And I know you guys are wondering how much this thing sold for. $105.50. And then consider the date. It's the first year of the Lincoln Memorial, sure, but you know, they made over a billion of these, so they're like, they grow on trees, literally. They are that common, and the condition is not good. It's got a little bit of like corrosion or some sort of rim damage here on the reverse. So, but the big selling feature obviously won the day on this one. $105.50. I mean, kudos, congrats to the seller. Nice haul. Well, what do I always say? Check your silver, check your scraps, because you might find something like this. We have a pair of coins with obvious, really shallow rim clips right here. So they're kind of like in the same spot. That's funny. But we have a 1934 and we also have a 1944. I don't think these had, well, one, the 44 hat is a Denver, so that does have a mint mark. This 34 is a Philly. Coins are relatively in nice shape. I would say they're probably more along the line of AU. The 44 looks like it has a couple scratches here on the reverse. But yeah, very, very shallow rim clips. I'm sure a lot of silver stackers have probably overlooked stuff like this. But 17 bids altogether, and then you win yourself $24.50 compared to the actual silver melt value. I think that's pretty good. These are what, 250 a piece, at the time of this recording, as far as melt value. And then also from the same seller, we have a trio of Buffalo nickels, all exhibiting lamination issues, which buffaloes are commonly known for, just a bad at annealing on these. So this one right here, it's an S mint. This is where your lamination is. It's 35, has a nice little swath of lamination. There's also a little retained piece there. And then this 1930 something has one that's pretty long up and down. So there you go. Yeah, nice little lamination set here, three coins. That top left one is 1930. I actually had a secondary image. 35, that's a 30S, 35, and then whatever that mystery one is down at the bottom. Again, yeah, another lot of coins here. This one just so happens to sell for the same amount of money as the two dimes before it, 11 bids, $24.50. So you're looking at about $8 a piece. Not sure if it's really worth it. You know, these are worth about 8 to 12 bucks on a good day, and I figured this is a good day. So if you need some laminations for your coins or for your set or your buffaloes, this would be a good little lot right here. But if you got them and you need to sell them, just know that you can make some money off of them, for sure. Wow, here's another one right here too. A 1889 Liberty Nickel. I mean, look at the reverse right there. That was a previous clamshell lamination at one point, and then the piece just fell off. So it's just a really wild half lamb reverse on there. It's just crazy looking. I've owned a few of this type of lamination before. I never owned one on a Liberty Nickel, but that's pretty awesome. This one right here, 17 bids, sold for $38.51. So we have another mystery Buffalo nickel because there's no date, but it's a really nice, generous, high quality specimen. I would say it's probably like XF45. It's got a full horn, lots of detail on good old black diamond right here. But what's up with that date? Well, it is on the highest spot of the coin. And you also have a little bit of weakness right here in the middle of the braid and going into the cheek area. So this one was struck through a nice little smattering of grease. There's even a little bit of a lamination right here between the INT and the United, so that's pretty cool as well. But yeah, there is a this is a greaser, so you have a strike through here all over the date and in this area as well. This one right here sold for $29.99. So that's a good one to cherry pick out of the coin shop bin. Probably originally purchased for a buck or two, but that's a pretty nice flip there. Another week, another Wisconsin high-low leaf quarter. This time we have a what is this? A low leaf. These are all 2004 Denvers. Every single one of them is produced in Denver. They were all dropped at one point during its release in the southern U.S., like Texas, Oklahoma, Arkansas. And then over the years, they just kind of radiated throughout across the country. So now you could probably, I think one that I had touched on here in the last week once sold on the East Coast. So I don't know if that was found in Massachusetts or wherever it was sold at, but one did sell from that area, New England. This one right here sold for $93.25, and that's with three bids combined. Pretty nice high-end example, pretty luster. I mean, this is a collector grade right here. Uh-oh, brand new penny alert, 2020. It's 1 year old, but we have one that is off center here by about what, 10%, maybe a little bit less than that. But hey, it's a brand new coin and it's off center struck, so this is going to appeal to those date specific collectors of this type of error. And this one right here sold for, oh man, $35, and that's with nine total bids. So we had a number of people that were very interested in this. So as you can see, with the few coins I talked about with just a number of bids on them, that kind of helps us understand what the market is right now. When you look at coins like this and there's nine bids, there's probably three unique bidders. And then they're just going back and forth, and they decide, oh yeah, 30, $35 is just, that's the cap on something like this. The buying mentality is always in that, there's always going to be another one that'll pop up in the marketplace, and that might be true, but the further you get away from the actual release date of these coins, the more rougher condition they're going to be. All right, so something to keep in mind. Don't hold on to these too long. Strike while the iron's hot. Oh boy, another statehood quarter. It's our good old friend Idaho with the big giant bird body on the reverse. But yeah, you guys see it. All the starburst action on the obverse and on the reverse too as well. Yeah, this one was struck through a light smattering of grease on that die. So yeah, it's pretty neat. It just even encroached into the motto "In God We Trust." Almost threw me for a loop. I thought this was another Kansas "In God We Rust" quarter, but it's Idaho instead, famous for their potatoes. This one right here sold for $7.99. It's actually quite common to find these light strikethroughs like this on statehood quarters, so I would definitely keep an eye out for these. A 2000 Philadelphia Lincoln Memorial cent. So this is one of the more common dates for modern off-center struck coins. 98 to 2001, They were all quite common. So, there's quite a bit of these out there to fulfill demand, but they are still worth a few shekels. This one right here is off-center by about 15%, and it sold for $18.49. So we have a piece of currency here, another dollar bill, and this one is in pretty nice shape. It's a 1981 Fed Reserve note. As you can see, it's got one of those funky back to front wet ink offset transfer errors that I just love. This one is a partial. It's about 45% covered on the offers on the front of the note. But when the sheets are printed and they get stacked on top of each other, obviously the ink hadn't dried completely yet, so there's going to be some of that transfer of the ink, and it's always going to be in reverse. So all the letters that you see here under this crest is going to be in reverse. If it's going the other way where you could read it legibly, then it's a fake error. This one right here, through 13 bids, sold for $172 and 49 cents. There's a quick image grab of the back of the note. Pretty nice shape. I mean, I don't think it's circulated one bit. This could probably grade like maybe a 63 or 64. Now, I'll be honest, I've thrown a lot of these back, but I might have to go back and find them. This one is a 1955S, but rest assured, you could find these in just about any date of Lincoln cent, even into the memorials. But yeah, check out the reverse. Obvious weakness, a lot of strike through, probably through grease and debris. So you have a good portion of 1 cent missing here. The 0 and 1, obviously, and then some certain areas here in the United States of America. Keep in mind the condition. It's got some mechanics grease in there and all that great stuff. This coin has seen a lot of action during its day. Sold for $13.99. So you don't necessarily have to clean the grease. Just go ahead and take good quality images and throw them up on eBay. You'll do just fine. Not a fantastic or beautiful coin, but we have a 1974 D Washington quarter, an often forgotten date in the lore of clad Washington quarters. There's really not a whole lot going on here, but you probably saw it on the reverse. We got the old Spitting Eagle, which is simply just a die clash. All right, and that it's positioned at a point where it just looks like a stream of goo coming out of the eagle's beak. This one right here sold for $13. This is just like the floating roof, the Spitting Horse Delaware quarter, the In God We Rust, whatchamacallit, Kansas State quarter. These all have kind of like a very dedicated collector base, but it's more of a cult following. There's not thousands of people that collect these. They just think it's neat, you know? Here's another one of these offset transfers. This is another back to front. It's not completely 100%. This one's more on the lighter side, but you can see that this corner right here did not get covered at all. But it doesn't downplay the importance of this error. And mostly, I see a lot of these ungraded sold on eBay, and we've seen quite a few of them on the market here recently, especially over the summer. This is a 69A, $5 Fed Reserve note with that error. The back of the note is crispy clean. This one right here, ladies and gentlemen, sold for 5 cents shy of 300 bones. So 3C notes. And you're an owner of this note. Well, not anymore. It's gone. It's sold. Here's a 1989P Jefferson Nickel. A really nice high-grade specimen. Lots of great cartwheel luster. It's broad struck. Or maybe perhaps a little bit off center, but I'm more leaning toward broad struck because you do have an apparent rim edge over here on this area. But yeah, relatively minor broad strike here, and this one sold for $52.95. What do I say? Check your scrap silver because you might find one of these. No, I didn't intentionally re rotate the reverse of this 1922D Peace dollar, but it really does have a rotated reverse by about 30 degrees counterclockwise, or clockwise, not counter, just regular clockwise. It's got a little bit of a die crack here. It goes through the Y and into the hair bun. It's a decent looking coin. The rotated die reverse is what really gives this one all the value. This one sold for $116. Can you imagine finding this in a melt bin for like $28? You pick it up and then sell it for 116. That's a pretty good feeling. And I actually own one of these, not a 22D, but I do have a Peace Dollar slab by NGC that's actually rotated like 85 degrees. It is so nuts. I love these things. I believe this is the final off-center struck coin, 1984. You do have a full date on this one, and it's a Philadelphia struck example. Really nice high-grade type as well. Look for these at coin shows and shops. They normally don't charge enough for these. So if you do find them and it's a reasonable cost, pick it up. This one right here is off-center by about 70%. And it's sold for $20.99. That's a pretty good sale. Our final piece of currency for the week is going to be this well-loved, absolutely beat up $1 silver certificate this time. We have a silver cert. I don't talk about silver certificates that often, but this one has a really good reason for being on the list, other than the fact that, it looks like it's going to fall apart any second. But it's a 35E series, so it's a much older note. And on the back, keep in mind, look at the front. It looks pretty decent. The back, oh boy, the sheet was way misaligned before the reverse was even printed on. And as you can tell, see, the front is perfectly aligned. The back is crooked. So, but it still got cut, and it still got sent out into circulation. Look out for these. If you have a bunch of silver certificates and you don't pay attention to things like the third print in relation to the rest of the print, or you don't pay attention to the backs of them, you can miss out on stuff like this. This one sold for $150 by one of my favorite sellers on eBay, J.S. Cabani, who has been around the currency game for a long time. I would say probably 11 years plus, somewhere around there. That was back when I was collecting national banknotes, and he had quite a few of them that I was interested in. But he's still around. He's not as young as he used to be. He was kind of like a kid when he first came on the scene, and he had such ridiculous notes. And I'm wondering, man, how did he get all the money to afford some of them? But yeah, he still has quite the collection on eBay. 1929 Lincoln Weedy. We got a another nice sizable lamination on the obverse of the coin. The condition of the coin is not that great. Quite circulated. I would say it's probably like a VG somewhere around there. This one right here sold for $16.75. Easy money. Find these, pull them out. All right, we're down to the last two coins. By the way, were you keeping track? We have 30 coins total that we talked about tonight. We have a 1970D, which has a really cool and seldom seen reverse cut that's right over 1 cent there at the six to 8 o'clock position on the reverse of the coin. You do have the corresponding weakness on the opposite side of the coin. So when you do the regular coin turn, that's the weakness area. But yeah, that's really cool. Nice size cud die break on there. The bigger the cud, the more money that collectors throw at you. This one sold for $95, by the way. Pretty easy to miss too, considering that it's on the reverse and most people look on the front of the coin for cuds. And the condition is not all that great. It's circulated, but aside from that, it's not like a high-end wonder piece. And then how about one more cut to wrap it off? This time, a 1970D Jefferson nickel. This one has a cud right above Jefferson's crown. Cool. I think I've probably talked about one of these before. But heck, here's another one right here that's sold. And a best offer was accepted. The seller was originally asking $125. I'm pretty sure this is probably sold for around close to the same amount of money as the penny before it. 90 to 100 bucks, and yeah, that's a really strong sale. But what do you guys think? I would love to hear your thoughts on what your favorite coin of the week was, or in this video. Furthermore, hopefully this video gives you some inspiration to go and roll hunt one of our regular viewers of the live coin Q&A and my channel, Blue Ridge Silverhound, had found a really huge double diobverse on a bicentennial quarter. And we're going to talk about that in the upcoming live coin Q&A. Not this Monday, but the corresponding Monday, which is Labor Day weekend. We will be on September 6th. And we will also be giving away a copy of the Whitman 7th edition Mega Red Redbook. That thing is huge. It's like a brick. It's even thicker than your standard phone book, if that even still exists. But ladies and gentlemen, would love to hear your thoughts on your favorite coin. I'm your host, Sean, with Blue Ridge Silverhound. As always, don't forget to like if you enjoyed today's content. Dislike if you don't care about me or the content at all. Feel free to share the video, and as always, subscribe. Your extra support means the world to me. But that's gonna go ahead and do it. All good things come to an end, but have no fear. We're gonna do another one this weekend. Coinaholics, we are discovering together each and every single day. You guys take care. Have a wonderful evening, and I'll see you on the next coin video.